So for today's meeting, first is the attendance report. Cindy Strait has let me know that there are 238 folks here, registered people here today. So registration is closed and a quorum has been approved based on the number of attendees provided today. So we are good to go. I wanted to appoint acting secretary and acting parliamentarian today, Karis Karistopoulos. Karis, can you stand up, please? I'm appointing as today's secretary. She works with us in the board meeting. And Mr. Spear, if you could stand up. I want to appoint Barry Spear as our parliamentarian. He has been legal counsel for LPEA for a number of years. With that said, moving on, I'm looking for a motion to approve the agenda today. Moved by this corner. Is there a second? Seconded over here. All in favor say aye. Any opposed? All right, and then also looking for approval of the 2015 from last year annual minutes. Moved to approved again. Is there a second? Second over here again. All in favor say aye. All right, motion has been made. Thank you very much. With that, I want to move on to our legal counsel. Barry Spear is going to read the official notice of the meeting. Mr. Spear.
Thank you. Welcome everyone here on this kind of mixed weather day, but good to see you all here today. I am Barry Spear, the general counsel for La Plata Electric, and it's my responsibility to do a couple things. First is to acknowledge that the notice has been sent out, and pursuant to Article 2, Section 3 of the bylaws, this meeting was properly noticed. Not less than 45 days and not more than 10 days before today's date. And therefore, I would entertain another motion for acceptance and recognition that the notice was properly done. Could we have a motion for that, please? Thank you. This is the official meeting of the members for 2016, and we will proceed through the agenda that Michael pointed out and set forth for you all. I'd like to make a couple of additional announcements or statements. I'd like to state that Colorado law does require that if a ballot is submitted by mail, then a member is not allowed to vote or cast another ballot at this meeting, the annual meeting. So if you are not allowed to vote this morning, the reason for that is because you have already submitted your ballot by mail. Also, as allowed under Colorado law, La Plata Electric Board of Directors decided to select an independent third party to tabulate the ballots and determine the votes for the candidates. This year, the La Plata Electric Board selected La Plata County to tabulate those ballots, and the person leading that charge is Tiffany Parker, the county clerk. Moving into another area that I need to address, and that is the standing rules and procedures. In the packet that you received when you came in this morning, you will see that there are standing rules and procedures. And if you did not get a copy, if you'd raise your hand, I'm sure that one of the LPEA employees will come around and make sure that you have a copy of those standing rules. I would like to point out a couple things in the standing rules. Each candidate for director will be given 3 minutes to address the membership, and we'll move into that after I sit down. And also near the end of the meeting, those of you who would like to ask questions may certainly do so, and you're welcome to do so. And we'd like to state that you will have 2 minutes to pose your question, and then we'd like to limit it to 30 minutes for each topic. And the standing rules do state that no member may speak a second time on any particular question. So we do need a vote to accept the standing rules and procedures as presented. Can I have someone move to accept those? Thank you. And all in favor? And I guess I should go back on the notice too. I don't think I received a vote for all the membership. All those in favor of accepting the notice, would you say aye?
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Mr. Spear. So I wanna recognize some folks that are here today, and I'd ask those people stand up, and if everybody could hold their applause until the end. The list is a little long, so get comfortable. Let's go ahead and want to introduce the current candidates and incumbents. Again, if you could stand up, that'd be great. Mark Garcia to District 1. In the back, Mike Alley, District 1. And Colin McNeil, District 1. District 2, Dan Huntington and Lori Schell. District 3, Doug Lyon. He actually just texted me. He's in Germany right now. He wanted to know he's standing. District 4, Jack Turner, John Beebe, and Ron Bishop. And want to ask if everyone has had the opportunity to vote. Anyone who's not that really wanted to. All right, so let's officially close the ballot box. Let's give everybody, these folks, a round of applause for willing to stick their neck out. All right, going to introduce some other folks. The other board members that are here today, District 1, if you could please stand, Bob Lynch and Bob Formwalt. District 2, Tom Compton, David Montoya, Kohler McGinnis. District 3, Jeff Berman and Britt Bassett. And District 4, Joe Wheeling and Karen Barger. If we could give them a round of applause, please. Thank our volunteers today, the Southern Ute Veterans Association, VFW Post 4031, the B Entertainment, B Frank students, LPEA employees that are here today, the Washington, D.C. Youth Tour winner, Miranda Talbot, the community volunteers, well, there's a variety of them, representing the La Plata County Fair royalty that were fantastic as we walked in, Fiesta Days royalty, Chimney Rock Interpretive Association, Durango Bluegrass Meltdown, Durango Cowboy Poetry Gathering, the Vallecito Nordic Association, the Silver Spruce Academy, ELHI, the Area Health Education Center, the TARA Historical Society, and the Bayfield Early Education Programs. If we give them a round of applause as well. And we're getting there. Let's see, also today, if you guys could stand as well, CEO Mike Drayspring, Miles Jensen, the Senior Manager of Member Relations with Tri-State G&T, Roundup Foundation, board members, Michelle Harris, Teresa Campbell, Cheryl Ayers, Werner Heiber, Doug Bowen, Carmen Hubbs, Jen Bartlett, I think that's it. And then a couple of some other local dignitaries here, La Plata County Commissioners Julie Westendorf and Brad Blake, if you could stand up. Durango City Council, the Mayor Pro Tem, Dick White, Mark Garcia, who's the acting town manager of Ignacio. Also wanted to recognize former LPEA board members Pam Patton, Lyndon Stewart, Harry Cole, Virginia Miller Cavanaugh, former LPEA CEO Greg Monroe, if Greg and Val could stand up, former Roundup board members Patty Clark, Robin Duffyworth, John Condi, Wanda Ellingson. And also we have from one of our neighboring co-ops from United Power, Director Tim Erickson is here. And also Tri-State, Brad Nebergall and Sarah Choman. And I think if I missed anybody. If I missed you, please stand up as well. I think that's it. Let's give everybody a round of applause, please. All right, so moving on, I wanted to introduce our speaker today. So we have a very special guest speaker today, Greg Aliff, and some of the board members heard him speak at a conference. We thought he was so good. We asked him to come and give talk at our annual retreat for the board members to kind of put a focus on what we're dealing with, what the future holds for electric. And that was so good that we asked him to come here today and give a talk to you. So just quickly, Greg Aliff, president of the Reston, Virginia-based GE Aliff Group, LLC, the advisory company founded in June 2015 to serve the energy and resource industry. For nearly 40 years prior, he served with Deloitte LLP, most recently as vice chairman and senior partner. And during his tenure, he led Deloitte's U.S. sustainability practice and was Deloitte's U.S. energy and resources industry leader for 10 years. So with that, please give a warm La Plata Electric Association welcome to Greg Aliff.
Good morning. Let me get this mic here. Good morning, everyone. I'm delighted to be here with you, and I'm delighted to have had the past association that was just mentioned with both the Colorado River Electric Association, a meeting that I attended in Denver, and with the La Plata Electric Board. Let me start out by telling you what I did yesterday. I took a little walk. It was nice to be here. The weather was great. I just came from the East Coast where it's been cold and rainy. And I took a walk on the river walk there in Durango. And I happened to walk by the sign that's there where the first electric power plant was built in Durango in 1887, and almost 130 years ago. And as I sat there and paused thinking about it and thinking about what I was going to say to you today, it reminded me, what struck me was the fact that in many respects, not much has changed in this industry for that 130 years in terms of how the business has run. It has obviously gotten much, much bigger than it was in the past, much more complex. Many, many more people obviously have electricity today. But the basic model, in many respects, has stayed the same. And the tenets that were there from the very beginning have stayed the same. And that was the goals, three common goals, to provide safe, reliable, and affordable electricity to consumers. And I've had the good fortune, as I said, this was to serve this industry over many years. And I have to say that the track record in meeting those three basic tenets has been phenomenal, and for that matter, remarkable across that period of time. But I'm not here today to tell you about how great the history of this industry has been. I'm here to tell you that I believe that the fundamental change in this industry is about to take place and why I believe that's the case. And so for just the next few minutes, my message to you is basically going to be four things. First, that change is inevitable in this industry, and I'll talk a bit about what I mean by that change, and that no electric company is going to be insulated or isolated from that change. This change is obviously going to present tremendous challenges, but it's also going to present tremendous opportunities for those that choose to seize them. And I also believe that the utility cooperative structure, the structure that La Plata Electric has, is uniquely positioned in many respects to take advantage of those changes. And I'll explain why in a moment. And finally, what hasn't changed, and I don't believe will change, is that the successful electric utilities of the future will be those that do what electric utilities have done in the past, and that is continuously find ways to add incremental value to its customers, both businesses and consumers. So with that, I'm going to go through a couple of slides and just comment on some of the things that I see happening to kind of support those basic tenets that I laid out for you. If I hit the right button here, we'll see. Yes. Let me briefly explain why I see this as inevitable. I had the good fortune over several years to write three papers that we call the Math Series. The first one was The Math Does Not Lie. The second one was Beyond the Math. The third one is The New Math. And I'm going to focus my next few moments, remarks, on this idea of the math does not lie. The whole premise here is that equations are equations. And if you know the variables in the equation, the answer is what it is. You can't debate the answer. If you take a very simple equation where the denominator is the cost of electricity, the numerator, the denominator is the number of kilowatt hours consumed by customers, then you've got the cost per kilowatt hour. Now, the challenge is obviously, if you're looking into the future, is to be able to predict what that cost of electricity is going to be and how many kilowatt hours are going to be sold. But do you really have to know exactly, precisely, what those variables are as long as you know directionally where they're going? And most of the subject of this first paper was around the fact that, and I know it's a little bit of a busy slide, but the bottom line on this is, with the exception of new technology efficiencies, everything would indicate that the price of electricity or the cost of electricity to consumers going forward is going up. In many respects, that's not a dramatic change from in the past. There's one dramatic factor there that I will point out in a moment. But the cost has gone up over time, for no other reason than inflation and other things. But there are lots of things making costs go up today. On the other hand, what's been called into question is what's going to happen with the kilowatt hours consumed by customers. And the reality seems to be, over the past 4 or 5 years, is that the kilowatt hours consumed by customers is actually flat or declining. And in many respects, it's because of efficiency technologies that have allowed consumers to get the same benefits of electricity with less kilowatt hours consumed by that consumer. And some people, so if you take that equation, and again, not knowing the amounts of the variables, but knowing the direction, then you know the direction of the answer. And that is, if the costs are going up and the kilowatt hours consumed are going down, the cost per kilowatt hour is going up. Now, some people a couple years ago labeled this the death spiral. And the reason they labeled it that is because as the cost increase and consumption goes down and the cost per kilowatt hour goes up, that means more efficiency technologies that heretofore didn't exist or heretofore were too expensive to implement will become reasonable to implement. And customers will implement those because now they're justified on a cost economic basis, which will drive the denominator down further, which will drive the answer up further. And therein, I think, many believe lie the dilemma that the industry faces today across the United States. This next slide I'll be very brief on. It simply suggests, when we did these papers, that the foundation to the industry is already today beginning to shake as a result of these phenomena that I just mentioned a moment ago. And there are two basic reasons why. There's two basic things that are really going on here that's causing this to happen, as I mentioned a moment ago. I called it the license to do business. Those three basic tenets I mentioned on the front end, that electricity has to be safe, reliable, and affordable. Well, there's a fourth one that has entered in the recent past, and that it must be environmentally responsible. And no longer can you produce electricity without the environmental implications being considered. And I think most everyone agreed that is a very important tenet, obviously, to add to the business, to the license to do business. But the important point is it comes with a cost. And that's not to suggest that you shouldn't do it, but it does come with a cost, and that has to be acknowledged. And that, in part, is the phenomenon that we are witnessing with the numerator that I mentioned a moment ago. The other piece is the part that everybody's found very interesting in the recent years and continues today, and that is this whole idea that the fundamental participants in what I called the game were the electric company itself, its investors, its owners, and its regulators to the degree that there's a form of regulation that exists. I argued that that has changed also going forward because we now have this world of what we call new market entrants. Some call them disruptors to the model, and I'll speak a bit more about them in a moment. But I think the important thing on this slide is the definition that we put on disruption to the model that exists today. That's not to suggest that the model is destroyed or anything. It suggests that the model as we know it is going to be significantly disrupted. And that is, and I will read it, circumstances where the traditional central generating station model, where the electricity is generated centrally, transmitted, and distributed, ceases to function as the primary provider, not the only provider, but the primary provider of safe, reliable, affordable, and environmentally responsible electricity service to customers, both businesses and consumers. That means there are others that have entered into that process in a meaningful way. Now this next slide, I think you'll find the message behind it to be very interesting. The slide itself is a bit busy. But what we did in the third paper I wrote was we actually developed a model that we put together. And we actually tested it across a number of the thought leaders across all aspects of this electric industry to validate the model. And basically we were modeling where will this disruption to the model that has existed today occur first in the United States. And I'll explain in a moment why where it occurs first matters. Because it's not going to happen. We all know it's not going to happen equally across the country. The elevator speech, so to speak, or the summary of what this map really tells you is that disruption is already occurring today in California and in Hawaii. In Hawaii, it's because the price of electricity is about 3 times the average on the mainland of the United States. And in California, because of both policies that they have in California and the price of electricity. Disruption is already taking place. But the model also, more importantly, showed that the top 10 states where disruption will occur first are all in the northeast part of the United States. And so my message for the past couple of years has been to audiences like yours, has been keep an eye on what's going on in the northeast, because that's where we're going to start to see things emerge in terms of technologies, in terms of policies, in terms of different ways to get electricity to consumers. And then why is that important when you sit in Colorado? It's important because most of these changes that are going to take place are going to be policy changes to deal with the issue of rising electricity prices. And the other thing it's going to be is going to be technologies that are going to heretofore haven't been, you know, tested, tried, and found to work that are going to start to work. And policies and technologies simply have no boundaries. State lines, utility borders, they don't keep technologies out. If it works for someone in one place and provides them value and benefit, it'll work for someone else. And I believe that's one of the more important things to realize is that what's happening elsewhere in this country will impact what's going to happen here. Very briefly, the main point on this slide here is that practically all of the innovation, the real change that we're seeing today, is what we call behind the meter, or in the customer's home, or inside of the business that's consuming the electricity. It's not on the other side where the power is being generated, transmitted, and distributed. Yes, a lot's still going on there. But the real changes that are taking place are in the homes and are in the businesses, whether they are efficiency measures around efficiency or storage technologies or fuel cells or whatever they happen to be. That is where that's where the action is going forward. So what does La Plata Electric, what do others do? What are companies going to do to deal with these impending changes? Well, I argue that they're going to have to change their strategies, their approaches to what they do. And those changes can be defensive in nature to some degree, to defend the status quo where it makes sense to continue to defend the status quo because it's for the benefit of the customers. Or they can be offensive where companies literally actually go out and adopt new strategies and try to bring new value to their customers that they haven't done in the past. And in my opening remarks, I said, I think that the cooperative structure is uniquely positioned to take advantage of these changes and to implement these new strategies. And the reason I believe that is I've spent the better part of my career, quite frankly, working with the investor-owned utilities, that are subject to state regulation. And I see state regulation for at least a while being a major obstacle that will exist for the investor-owned utilities that will not necessarily exist for the cooperative structures in terms of basically adopting strategies and doing things that benefit their customers. And therefore, I think there's a greater opportunity to seize the opportunities that exist for your customers and for you. Let me kind of quickly give you a couple of closing thoughts, a little bit of maybe of, and a little bit maybe of prognosis as we go forward. What you have on this slide is the results of a recent study that was done that quite frankly hasn't been published yet, but I was able to get a glimpse into the results of the study. This is a study that's been actually done for the past 4 or 5 years. The bottom line on this is that once again, this past February, March, when consumers and businesses across the entire United States were surveyed, they're not taking their foot off the pedal in terms of trying to achieve greater energy efficiency in their homes and in their businesses. They're continually looking for ways to do that. They do not see themselves going back to the levels of electricity that have been used in the past. And the manifestation of this is the continued fall of, in the amount of kilowatt hours consumed in most utilities across the United States, flat or lower after being weather adjusted. So you don't see them going back, and if you can see the numbers on businesses, they're rather astonishing. On average, businesses are targeting approximately a 28% reduction in electricity they consume over an average time horizon of 4.8 years. And they view their most recent successes to be in about the 19% range. Now, an important asterisk to that, and that is, that's the electricity they consume from traditional sources. That doesn't mean they're not actually putting in their own self-generation in many cases. But that's part of the reduction that we're talking about here. It's not necessarily total reduction in kilowatt hours, but what they have consuming from their traditional sources that they've gotten it from in the past. So what does this mean? Well, I think it obviously means that the denominator that I talked about earlier, if we look into that future, into the crystal ball, is going to continue to go up. And the question is a bit more about the numerator. Maybe this is maybe my closing thought for you. I think that today, the pace of change that we're about to see has the potential to accelerate beyond what we've seen for the past couple of years. And it all lies in one factor. And that's something I think we're all familiar with, and that is the low prices today that exist for natural gas from petroleum products, but particularly for natural gas. Natural gas makes such a substantial portion of the electric power produced in this country today. And as probably many of you know, a number of very well-run, profitable nuclear power plants across this country are closing down simply because they can't compete, even though the price of their fuel is practically zero. They can't compete with a brand new gas-fired plant when the price of natural gas is in the low $2 range. I believe that, obviously, natural gas prices can't stay in that range. They have to rise. And when they rise, so will the price of electricity. As the price of electricity rises, these things that I have mentioned around technologies and so forth, I believe will accelerate in terms of the pace of adoption across companies. So my kind of final message to you is that what else hasn't changed through all this is the fact that a customer-first strategy is the one that's going to be the winner in the future, as it has been in the past. And in my mind, that customer-first strategy is one that embraces the changes that are coming in the future, looks into that crystal ball, and sees where consumers can benefit from it and adopt strategies and policies and implements them for the benefit of their customers. Thank you, and I'm delighted to have an opportunity to be with you today.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Karen Barger, and I currently serve as the board treasurer. I would like to thank Mr. Dennis Savanas, the CFO, and his team for their good work this year. And Mr. Savanas will be available later if you have any questions he might be able to help answer. So the financial status of the cooperative, I'm happy to report, is in good health. The independent audit firm of BKD was in-house for this work, and we have a clean audit, and we have met all of our financial obligations. If you're interested as a member and would like to see further results, you may log into your Smart Hub and look at the audit report. The team also was able to refinance some debt. In 2015, we refinanced approximately $26 million. The new CFC loans replaced multiple loans that we had with RUS. The weighted average of those RUS loans was about 5.1%. So the new weighted average of the loans that we have replaced now comes in at 3.9%, with the total savings to the members of approximately $7.2 million. This slide shows the equity, which is the measurement of the members' financing plant and other assets versus financing with borrowed capital, or basically it shows how much of the assets are owned by the members versus what is financed by the banks. This is about our kilowatt hours sold. As was mentioned by Mr. Aliff, we are becoming more efficient. You can see that there is a bit of a decline. Part of this is due to the fact that we have some great energy efficiencies. There is good local distributed generation. We've also had mild weather, and then there's the opportunity for changing industrial loads. The total assets, this slide refers roughly to the $320 million in assets for your cooperative. This one is about as clear as mud. You might see that there's a slight decline. We had over $10 million of additions to our plant, and this was paid mostly with cash. We also had $9.1 million in depreciation. We had capital credit retirements of $4.4 million to our members, and we had principal payments of $5.5 million. We also received $1.3 million of patronage retirements from other members, other member co-ops. In other words, it's complicated, and it has a lot of moving parts. This last slide I have for you today is a chart showing the amount of property taxes paid by La Plata Electric in 2015. This is an additional and direct economic benefit to the communities that we serve. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Karen Barger, our secretary, or I'm sorry, our treasurer. And I apologize, we skipped over the president's report. It's only a few minutes, so it's okay. Let's see, a couple of things I wanted to mention. So this is my, today's my last day on the electric board. I'm moving on to some educational goals that I wanted to get to. But I just wanted to make a few comments looking back over the last 3 years. A couple of things. One of those is that LPEA is a very strong organization. Any organization that has been around for 76 years is doing something right. I think we're doing a good job. We have an extremely dedicated staff. If staff is in the room, can you raise your hand real quick? Can we give those folks a round of applause? I mean, they're the ones that literally keep the lights on. We also have a very dedicated board, and as you might have heard, we have a very diverse board, and I think that's a good thing. When I was thinking about what I was going to say, I was just reflecting on it's a very diverse board, but I think it also represents the diverse community that we live in and the diverse perspectives, and even more so, the diverse country that we live in and the different perspectives that are out there. And as Mr. Aliff pointed out, it's not going away. There's a lot of changes coming up, and there's going to continue to be different perspectives. And having served on a number of boards, I think the worst board you can have is a board that everyone has the same opinion in the board. And there's really no intellectual debate. There's really nothing exciting going on. And luckily for us, we don't have that. So I guess the comment I would have for our board, but for all of us, in a living in a diverse community, in a diverse world, can be very challenging. And I would just say, moving forward, I think the way that we work with that is that we keep our passion. I'm not suggesting anyone change their positions. I think you fight passionately what you believe in. But you do so with a sense of humility, knowing that you don't have all the answers, none of us have all the answers, and being open to learning new things. And finally, don't be afraid to be happy, because the candidate you want isn't always going to win, and if they win, they're not always going to vote the way you want them to vote, and your next-door neighbor is going to not always view the same things same way that you do, and that's okay. It's not the end of the world. Life is still good. Thank you very much. With that, I'm going to introduce our CEO, Mr. Mike Drayspring.
Well, I wanted to take just a couple of minutes to recognize a couple of people today, and I appreciate the opportunity to present to you. I appreciate you coming out and spending the morning with us. One person I'd like to recognize, I'll tell you a little story before I introduce her. There was a dinner party, and Winston Churchill's guest had asked him, if you were reincarnated, what would you want to be? And without hesitating, he said, Lady Churchill's second husband. And that's kind of how I feel about my wife. I would like to introduce her, because she's been a big supporter of mine throughout our 37 years of marriage. But Sabra Drayspring, would you stand so we could recognize you? I also wanted to give you an opportunity to recognize I have a couple of plaques, but can't locate those right now. But, you know, we do have two directors that did not run for re-election. Michael Rennan, here they are. Thanks, Jeff. Served 3 years as a board member, and also in the time that I've been here has been the board chairman. And I'd like for you to have an opportunity to recognize his years of service. This is presented to Michael Rennan, with gratitude and appreciation for many years of dedication and service to the members of La Plata Electric Association. Thank you. I'd like to also give you an opportunity to recognize Tom Compton, who has been a director. He's concluding his 18th year. And both of these gentlemen have represented your interest well. They have also been, you know, catalysts for learning and for understanding. They're both going to be missed. And with gratitude, Tom Compton, with gratitude and appreciation for many years of dedication and service to the members of La Plata Electric Association. Thank you. Thank you, Tom. So I'm going to step down off stage and just cover a couple of things. I had a couple of items that I wanted to cover with you today, and I stepped off stage without the clicker. There we go. Pays to be tall. One other group I would like to recognize, because this is really kind of one of the things that we do here, whether it's being a cooperative business or whatever we do, we enjoy a lot of freedoms in this country, right? And those freedoms come at a cost. And we have a lot of people in our midst who have served our country in the military. So if you have served our country in some branch of the military, would you please stand so that we can take a minute to express our gratitude to you? For those that stood, the members of La Plata Electric, thank you for your service to our country. One thing I wanted to talk to you about was a change that we put in after last year's annual meeting. We've made some changes to the election process. It's a policy 127. You can go out on our website and look at this. But it was to institute an election supervisory committee. And this is made up of members, one from each one of the board districts, of the cooperative. The members of the Election Supervisory Committee are from District 1, Archuleta County, Mason Carpenter; District 2, Cheryl Ayers; District 3, or Durango, Marilyn Sandstrom; and District 4, Betsy Romier. And we set this up because, you know, in the election process, although that policy directs us to go outside for an independent party to oversee the ballot, If there are issues that arise, you know, if there was a question or if someone disagreed with the result of the ballot count, we put this committee in place to be a deciding body to decide any and all disputes related to the election. So hopefully we don't have one this year, but this was something that we put in place so that those things could be resolved. We also provide legal and support administratively by LPEA, and they just oversee the election process for you. Now, one financial thing that I wanted to touch on in a little bit more detail is the issue of capital credits. You know, you're a member and you recognize that you're part owner of this association. But one of the things that's really important for you to recognize is that you have a stake or equity in this enterprise. Karen reported that we have over $300 million in assets. Would you have an equity stake in that? And how you put that equity in there is our margins. At the end of any year, if our revenue, and it should, exceed our expenses, what's left over we call margins. And we basically take that and we allocate that to all the members based on your patronage. And it's a very simple formula. We just take your bills for the year and we divide that by the total revenue, and then we multiply that times those margins, and that becomes your allocated portion of our margins annually. And we have to account for those annually, year to year. Now, what you see up here are basically two categories of margins, the one that LPEA produces and the one that we get from Tri-State, our Generation and Transmission Cooperative. They're cooperative. We're one of 44 member systems that is an owner of Tri-State G&T. So we allocate those margins separately. And you can see that I've listed the margins up here since 1994 up through 2015. This is the amount of capital credits we retire every year. If a cooperative is healthy, if we're able financially, and that's determined by your elected board of directors, we try to retire a portion of that. Tri-State retires some of their capital credits to us. When they do, we automatically refund that back to our members in the form of what we call a capital credit retirement. And that's just paying you back. For some members, you see that on your bill. Some members see a check. But you can see that LPEA, since 1994, has been good stewards of your equity money in terms of paying back capital credits to you. So since 1939, when the co-op was established, we've allocated a total of $182 million in capital credits to you. We've retired a little over $55 million, and we still have remaining $126 million unretired. Now, I'm not going to ask for any questions now, but if you have any questions during our Q&A about this or anything else, I hope you'll take some time to ask that question, because we'll be happy to answer that. And one other thing I'd like to put in a plug for, we're going to have a survey for you. It should be on your table, and we would like for you at the conclusion of today's meeting to fill that out. Give us your comments about the meal, any of the presentations, the registration process, anything. We'd like to hear from you how you think this meeting went, because that's what we're going to look for to try to improve our meetings year to year. So one of the things I want to talk to you about is Smart Hub. And right over here, and if Debbie Bass and Sue will give me a wave right there, they are kind of our desk. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about a way that you can learn to monitor and manage your electric account with LPEA. Because Greg was talking about energy efficiency, right? But a lot of that has to do with how you manage your usage. And Smart Hub is a great tool. So what I did here was I just took my iPhone, did a screenshot, and that's what you're looking at, is what basically came off of my iPhone, because I look at my account when my wife lets me. And this gives you some information. But one of the things it'll show you is your usage. Now, this is kind of broken out, you know, for the total year, and then shows a graph on average temperature, because more often than not, your usage is going to be related to weather, right? Some of you, that's not true, but for most of us, it is. Now, one of the reasons why this is really important is because one of the things that we changed at the first part of this year, we're going to talk a little bit about rates, and this is a great tool for helping you understand how to manage your electric cost, especially one of the changes that we made this year. All of you know that we entered into a settlement with Tri-State over the rate case that we brought against them. That settlement took them back from an all-energy rate back to demand and energy. For the members who have been with us for at least several years, you probably remember that we had a time of use rate that was very good for enabling members to save money. We had 5,000 of our members on the time of use rate. And when Tri-State went to an all-energy rate, we lost 60% of that. That dropped down to 2,000. So now that we're back on a demand and energy rate with Tri-State, one of the things that we did was we went back and restructured our time of use. Now, to give you an idea about what the savings can be for those of you who aren't on it, I asked LPEA, we took and looked at my account. And so what they did was they took the last year, and because we have advanced metering interval data for, you know, at least a year, we were able to go back and say, okay, if you took Mike Gray Springs' usage and you just applied the time of use and he made no changes, would he save money? Would it cost him more? What would it be? If I made no changes, I would save over $100 a year, all right? And so, and that's if I didn't change anything, but that also assumes that we had the same weather and everything else the last year, but basically, I can save money. So, next week, I'm going to be going to the billing department and saying I'd like to go on the time of use rate. Next year, when I talk with you, God willing, I'm able to talk to you, that I want to tell you how I did on that time of use, because it's not, I don't plan on doing nothing. I plan on trying to make some changes, again, that my wife lets me make, in our usage, and expect to be able to save more. And one of the reasons we're going into this level of detail with you is to let you know, even if you don't have electric thermal storage, you know, as a heating mechanism, we believe that you can save with our time of use rate. And so we want to tell you about that. We want to encourage you to use that. If you want to understand more about how to look at your usage and for additional help, join Sue and Debbie over here at the conclusion of our meeting today. They'll be glad to talk with you more about how to do that. One of the things that we did recently was we sent out surveys to all of our members. You guys probably saw that. So far, we just got the results of that this past week. I sat down on Wednesday with the lady that summarized that for us and looked at that. We had about 4,000 members that actually turned in their survey. So this is kind of based on our members' ranking. I'm not going to be going into detail about this. In fact, the consultant that we used to do the survey is going to be presenting the results of the survey at this month's board meeting, which will be May 16th. That's the Committee of the Whole meeting on Monday. Open meeting. Everyone's welcome to attend. And you're welcome to come and see the details of that. But this is a pretty big thing for me because it's a very simple equation. Like Greg was saying, to be consumer-centric, all we really have to do is make sure that we're hearing what you're saying, you know, how we're doing, whether it's rates or whether it's service. And those are some of the questions that we asked this year. So one of the things that we did learn that I can share with you is that we recognize we've got some work to do in the area of cost of electric service. And whether it's the time of use rate that we're trying to give you to empower you to save money with your energy use, we still recognize that one of the relative comparisons that we got from you in the results of the survey was we need to pay attention to this. So this is going to be a key area of focus for me as your CEO. One of the other things that we heard is how best to communicate with you. We ask you a variety of questions. You know, do you rely on your bill to get communications from us? Colorado Country Life, our website. And we got responses from you that told us how we best communicate with you. And it was really interesting because we broke that down between people that get a paper bill, and I'm really amazed but proud of how many of our members that get just an e-bill. My wife and I do. We don't get a paper bill. And it was interesting to see the different responses for people, whether they got electronic bills or other bills. And I'll share more of this information with you guys next year. I just didn't get all of the data. I just looked at it on Wednesday, and we're going to be going over this with the board. But the reason I wanted to tell you this is because as a co-op, it's really important for us to emphasize that we're going to listen to what you have to say. We're going to try to improve on the survey process. It could be better. And so that's one of the things that we're going to be working on, is if we're going to improve our serve to you, it's going to be by listening to how you're assessing the job that we're doing and what we can do better. I wanted to share just a little bit with you about where I see the market headed, because Greg Aliff told you a little bit about globally where the energy industry is going, in particular the electric industry. But one of the things that I continue to see is a lot of interest from our members in local distributed generation. Whether it's in people with solars, people that we have on net metering, we're approaching 750 accounts that have solar systems that are net metered. In other words, if they produce more than they consume, we're buying that back from them. So probably more than any cooperative with whom I'm familiar, LPEA has a very aggressive membership in the area of distributed generation, and we don't see that changing anytime soon. We're also seeing other distributed generation projects. For example, one of the agreements we entered into this year was with the Southern Ute Tribe, who are building a utility-scale solar project on tribal property for the benefit. They got a DOE grant, and so we entered into negotiations and entered into a purchase power agreement with them, and they're starting construction on that this year. Tri-State, our power supplier, continues to deal with some unprecedented change. They're seeing pressure on coal and from a variety of sources. You know, and that tells us several things. It tells us, you know, that may not be a long-term source for them. We expect to see some shifts in that. And so what happens if that happens? Is Tri-State being proactive? And one of the things that we saw them do just this last year was enter into agreements for some utility-scale renewable projects, some solar, some wind. So we're starting to see that migration and that change, you know, at a large bulk power level toward renewable energy. We see deregulation in the bulk power market in the western U.S., and at Tri-State's annual meeting last month, they said what we're seeing, which is that's going to happen sooner rather than later. So, I mean, having come from different parts of the U.S. where I've been in a competitive market, I'm telling you, deregulation is inevitable. It's not an experiment. It works in other markets. It's going to have a huge impact that I think are going to benefit LPEA's members. But it's important for your board and my management team and us to stay engaged in that, because as that evolves, we have to understand that to make sure that we're positioned to take advantage of that on your behalf. Right now, we see electric market prices are depressed. There's an abundance of generation right now in the Western market, and until that slack is taken up, we're seeing those bulk power market prices that are depressed. And so we think that that's going to last for, you know, some time, and that has a slight impact on us because Tri-State does buy some power in the open market. We're going to continue to leverage technology to empower you guys, and that's why learning and understanding how to use things like Smart Hub are going to be really important for you in the management of your electricity cost. That is all that I had. Again, I want to remind you, if you have questions or you have comments, hope that you will stay for the Q&A session. My management team and we have some representatives from Tri-State. If you have questions, we're going to try to get you answers today. If for some reason I don't have the answer today, we're going to do what we did last year, which is we're going to post your question and our response or answer. If we have to do some additional research, we're going to get you the correct answer, and we're going to provide that information through our website. Thank you again for attending today, and we appreciate your support of LPEA.
Good morning. My name is Kohler McInnes, and I was asked to spend a few minutes this morning and speak to you about Roundup. And the reason that I was asked to speak to you about Roundup is because up until a year ago, I was not a fan of Roundup. But I did do a 180-degree turn. I became a fan. And after being on the Roundup board for the last year, I am now an advocate for Roundup. So the question asked is, why were you not a fan of Roundup? And I kind of summarize that with my three didn'ts, and I'll answer my three didn'ts. The first one is I didn't understand who was receiving these funds and for what purpose. Well, it turns out that each month the Roundup board meets, they have the Roundup funds collected for that month. 30% of those funds are earmarked each month for the most needy in our communities. And those funds are channeled through two different vehicles. In La Plata County, that's the Community Emergency Assistance Coalition, And in Archuleta County, it's the Pagosa Outreach Connections. Well, that still leaves 70%. And there's many different organizations with different purposes that apply for those funds. And I can tell you that those organizations and those purposes are as diverse as you can imagine. My second is I didn't know the impact these funds would have. Well, about the second month that I was enrolled in Roundup, I was curious of what portion of my electric bill would be for Roundup. So I looked at my bill, and the total contribution to Roundup for that month was 21 cents. Now I have to be honest with you. I can't remember the last time that I spent less than 25 cents on anything other than a parking meter. If you are an investor or you're looking for an investment, it doesn't get better than this, because that 21 cents translated into $7,000 for that month's Roundup funds. And if we look at last year, 2015, those 12 months translated into $85,000. But the investment gets better. If we look at last year, the total expenses for Roundup to operate for the entire year was $2,000. And that comes in around 2 to 3%. So if we go back to my 21 cents, that 2 to 3% is less than a penny. So what did I get for my investment of less than a penny? Well, number one, I got LPEA, which is a very community-oriented organization, to join me and support me in strengthening our communities. And number two, I got those 11 directors on the Roundup board to spend 66 hours approximately that month to effectively and efficiently distribute my 21 cents. The third is I didn't know what it cost to become a participant in Roundup. Well, the way Roundup works is if you are a participant, each month LPEA will round up your electric bill to the next highest dollar. So the maximum contribution you'd make in any month is 99 cents. The average participant contributes right around 50 cents or approximately $6 a year. So I have a request. And my request is that each and every one of you in this room, please consider becoming a participant of Roundup. And if you already are a participant of Roundup, please consider becoming a participant of Roundup Plus. So what is Roundup Plus? Roundup Plus is where maybe you feel you can do a little bit more than your Roundup contribution. Again, going back to that month at 21 cents, I looked at that and I thought, you know, I can probably do a little better. And maybe you might say, hey, I could do a dollar a month. If you did that, well, in a year, that'd be $12 for your Roundup Plus, about $6 for your Roundup. So you'd be in the ballpark of about $18. Now, the reason for my request is that each month, the request for funds is much larger than the funds we have available for distribution. So we're trying to build a program, and we need your help. If you are a participant of Roundup, or if you are a participant of Roundup Plus, I have a message for you. And this message comes from the recipients of your donated funds, from the directors of the Roundup Board, from the LPEA staff, and from our communities. And that message is, thank you very much. Your donated funds are sincerely appreciated. Well, folks, I hope you have a good lunch today. Please consider Roundup. And for many of you in this room, an early happy Mother's Day. Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning.
Can you hear me?
Great. I'm Jeff Berman. I am our Colorado Rural Electric Association representative. CREA is a statewide trade association that we are a member of, along with, see if I can get this to work now, there we go, along with 21 other distribution cooperatives statewide. So we have an office based in Denver, and for all of our distribution cooperatives, Colorado Rural Electric Association offers a number of services. Possibly the largest function that we have is we lobby at the state capitol and participate with our National Trade Association on matters that will affect us as electric consumers and electric cooperatives. I sit on the building efficiency, the finance, and recently was added to the legislative committee as well. This year, we have a split legislature in the Colorado legislature. One house is controlled by one party and the other by the other. And that generally tends to lead to a fairly quiet legislative session. And so we did not have any terribly burning issues that we had to address this year. But a couple of note, including bills on biomass related to a project partly in Pagosa Springs. And also at the very end of the session, there was a bill that CREA had introduced successfully that would prevent additional taxes from being levied on electric consumers that were not intended. So we have an excellent working relationship at CREA, and both CREA and NRECA, the National Rural Electric Cooperative Association, provide us a tremendous amount of value that our guest speaker today alluded to. And that is that we need to be paying attention very carefully to the changes in the electric industry that are coming upon us. I'll get back to those in a few minutes. But first, a couple other major developments in the last year. CREA has a political action committee that many of us donate to that endorses candidates for election. And there have been some concerns about that process. And once we had an opportunity to address those concerns, the Political Action Committee adopted all the changes that we were looking for to help ensure transparency in that process, to allow the distribution co-ops to participate in that process and provide input on their selection of candidates that they would endorse, and also to ensure that each of those candidates is better informed that it is CARE, the Colorado Advocates for Rural Electrification, the Political Action Committee that is endorsing them, and not necessarily CREA, or as some of our members thought in the past, La Plata Electric endorsing those candidates. So with our great working relationship with our colleagues, we were able to get all those changes adopted that we sought in the last year. We also spent some time last summer in the LPEA boardroom addressing some of the National Rural Electric Cooperative Association's resolutions. And what these resolutions are documents and statements of position that guide the staff in addressing legislation and regulations that come before government bodies. And so we actually negotiated in our boardroom some mutually agreeable amendments or proposed amendments to those NRECA resolutions last year. Those were not adopted, and this was at the urging of our CEO. Those were not adopted at NRECA at their regional meeting in Salt Lake. However, we've seen some pretty significant changes, which I'll come back to. There's a number of meetings that we attend typically on an annual basis. NRECA has their annual meeting. This year was in New Orleans, our regional meeting in Salt Lake City, and often we're headed to Denver to attend CREA meetings and go to their annual meeting as well. That's how we gain education and we stay up to date on all these changes that are occurring in the utility industry so we can best make decisions that help protect the assets that we all together have put into our system. At NRECA, we didn't see those changes that we sought, largely crafted between myself and former CREA Director Tom Compton. But we have seen quite a change at NRECA, and they are sending us a very clear message that we need to be paying attention, we need to stay educated, and I won't go through each of these points that I've noted, but both at the annual meeting and a strategic technologies course that CREA and NRECA put on, in no uncertain terms, they are advising us that we need to be very engaged to ensure that we're protecting your assets. So here's a few of those recommendations that they are providing us. I won't go into the details of each one, but I would be happy to answer any questions afterward about any of these specific details. Thank you for your time. We appreciate you joining us at the annual meeting, and I will next leave it off to our Tri-State Representative, Joe Wheeling. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Joe Wheeling, the Tri-State Representative. As many of you know, Tri-State is a not-for-profit cooperative owned by 44 member systems, including La Plata Electric. Tri-State generates or purchases power that is delivered to its members across a vast 5,500-mile transmission network. Collectively, Tri-State's members serve 1.5 million people over a 200,000-square-mile area of the West. I want to update the membership on two areas. One, the association's approach to renewable energy, and two, the process to change Tri-State's wholesale rate structure. Both of these issues are important and impactful for LPEA's members. Now, I've heard from many of you that it is important we invest in renewable resources. For many years, Tri-State had a reputation of being slow to consider renewable resources, and that reputation frustrated many of you. It's true that Tri-State has been measured in its approach to renewables, but this approach was prudent given the state of the industry not too long ago. As technologies have improved and costs have come down, renewables have become a viable option both operationally and economically. For example, larger and more efficient wind turbines have increased capacity factors and lowered costs. The price per watt of solar panels has fallen significantly as technology and manufacturing processes have improved. Now, this slide shows the Tri-State 2015 resource mix, and I'm going to use that here as a baseline going forward. So, the time is right to make more significant investments in renewable energy. In 2009, Tri-State announced what at the time was the largest solar project in the country, the 30-megawatt Cimarron project in New Mexico. Later, Tri-State's first large-scale wind project was announced. While these projects were good deals at the time, we continue to see prices come down. In fact, the projects we are approving now are coming in at half the cost of those first projects. The board approved three projects in 2015. These include 55 megawatts of solar that comes online this year, split between projects in southern Colorado and southern New Mexico, as well as a 76 megawatt 2017 wind project in southeast Colorado. Tri-State's largest renewable project to date, the 150 megawatt Carousel wind farm in eastern Colorado, will be fully available later this year once the transmission system improvements are complete. What does all this mean? It is forecasted that in 2016, 25% of the energy Tri-State and its members will deliver to co-op members will come from carbon-free renewable resources. That puts Tri-State and La Plata among the leading utilities for renewables in the country. Now, shifting gears to the rate design process, the association's wholesale rate is important to you as an LPEA member because the rate affects our costs, your electricity bills, and how we structure our energy efficiency and renewable programs. The rate design that Tri-State adopted several years ago presented challenges to many of the association members, including La Plata Electric. The board sought to resolve these issues, and beginning in 2014 and continuing into 2015, a committee consisting of local cooperative board of directors, managers of the cooperatives, and Tri-State board members worked together to develop a model of Tri-State's costs, as well as recommending a new wholesale rate design. Tom Compton represented La Plata Electric and did a fantastic job for us. Through this member-governed process, the committee came to a unanimous rate recommendation that the board adopted in September. Tri-State's new and more traditional rate design better positions LPEA to meet the needs of our members. The fact we reached a new rate design, building consensus by working together as part of a cooperative family, speaks volumes about the way Tri-State's board and its executive management team are approaching the challenges in the industry. LPEA has a say at Tri-State, which is one of the significant benefits of being a member of a cooperative generation and transmission association. While there are many challenges and opportunities, I might add, ahead, Tri-State's performance in 2015 demonstrates we are being listened to and are well served. Thank you.
You know, there are some advantages to speaking last. Those in front of you have addressed a number of the topics that you have down in your report, and so I can eliminate those. And in speaking last, I can also bring the meeting to a close so that all of you can get to dinner really quick. So let me jump into this and mention a few things. I did want to talk about a couple policies that the board did address and discuss and come up with a new approach this last year. Mike did talk about one of those policies, and I'll do a couple additional comments about that particular policy. But the first policy I'd like to talk about is policy 129, which deals with ethics for the board and the staff. One of the concerns of the board this year was how to address conflicts of interest of board members. Policy 129 does define what a conflict of interest is. And that policy is patterned after the Colorado statute, which does address conflict interests, but it also primarily is focused on financial interests. But conflicts of interest, as you all know, many times address matters that are not strictly financial in nature. So what the board elected to do is incorporate into the policy was to require the board members on an annual basis to fill out a list of interests that they might have that might be a conflict. And this list is to be reviewed by the board on an annual basis. If the list does not include some conflicts that occurred during the year, then those conflicts are also addressed by the board under policy 129. The board will review all the items that are listed on the board members' conflict of interest, and if it decides that those conflicts are indeed conflicts, what it will ask the conflicted board member to do to recuse himself from both the discussion and the vote on that particular matter. This is a change in procedure previously. Previously, that decision as to whether or not to review and vote on the matter was a decision by the conflicted board member. Now the board has the opportunity to review the conflict and decide if that particular member should step aside for the discussion and the vote on that issue. The other policy I did want to talk about was policy 127, which Mike did address. It does, a key component of that policy is the election supervisory committee. The policy has called for an election supervisory committee for at least 3 years and maybe longer. Up until last year, though, the makeup of the election supervisory committee was an LPEA board employee, the person who actually tabulates the ballots in the election and me. And if you all will recall, we did have quite a stir last year when the qualifications of a couple of the board members, the candidates, was challenged. And so that was proved to be quite a undertaking for the Election Supervisory Committee. And this year, the board decided to address that in a different way, to take it away from the employee, to take it away from the person next door counting the ballots, and to take it away from me a little bit. What the board decided to do is to appoint a member, a La Plata Electric member from each district to serve on that election supervisory committee. And the board believes that that's a better way to approach it, more impartial, and just basically a good, solid way to address any concerns, questions, or issues that have been brought up. As Mike, I think, indicated, we have not had any issues this year, so that's good. Maybe, maybe not. But it hasn't been tested, but it will be tested soon, I'm sure. But I think that was a real fundamental change that the board wanted to make in that election process. In addition to those key legal areas that we have provided the board, my firm has also helped La Plata Electric settle a lawsuit this last year with a member. We've also federal electric regulatory commission cases, two cases that are in front of that commission that might end up affecting La Plata Electric. One case is concluded, the other one is still in the process of being resolved by FERC. We've also provided legal answers to questions from the board, worked on contracts and easements with the staff, and upon request, rendered opinions regarding all aspects of the La Plata business. So it's been a good year for us, and in closing, I would like to thank La Plata Electric for once again allowing me to be the lead counsel in providing legal advice to the board, to the cooperative for the last 15 years. I'd also like to mention that Shay Denning, who was just made a partner in our law firm January 1, has also been serving La Plata Electric for the last 6 years. And my firm has provided legal advice for the cooperative for 40 years now. So we really appreciate that opportunity, and we look forward to providing legal assistance in the future too. With that, I will wish you all a very happy day.
All right, we're just wrapping it up here. A couple of things. So next, wanted to know if there's any unfinished business that we need to take care of from this last year. And if not, then we'll go on to the results of the election, and then there'll still be question and answer at the end. So I wanted to make sure people know that. Any unfinished business from this last year? Seeing none. All right, that's in that case. I'll ask Tiffany Parker with La Plata County Clerk to come up and give the election results. Ms. Parker.
Hi there. Can you hear me? I'm Tiffany Parker, La Plata County Clerk. It's a pleasure once again to assist with the La Plata Electric election. Our responsibility is to program the ballots, receive the ballots, document which members have voted, and then of course to tabulate the votes. And I don't want to miss my opportunity to thank my election judges that are here today. Buck Skillen, Trish Pegram, Dan Lynn, Pam Glasgow, and Paul Romier. And there was, along with that, there was five other election judges that assisted us in the office. And then also I want to thank my election administrator, Erin Hutchins. Couldn't have done it without her. And then of course the Election Supervisory Committee. That's been really a great group of people to work with and to assist us. So let's get to the results. We received a total of 5,499 ballots. And for District 1, Mike Alley, received 851 votes. Callum McNeil, 81. Mark Garcia, 641. Director elected for District 1, Mike Alley. District 2, Lori Smith Shell, 730. Dan Huntington, 1,310. Director elected for District 2, Dan Huntington. District 4, Jack D. Turner, 841. Ron Bishop, 262. John Beebe, 774. Director elected for District 4, Jack Turner. Thank you.